I have no idea what you're talking about. I totally had a lot of time to sit down and breathe and have dinner and take a shower and all of that. Yeah, I'm just kidding. I literally came inside my house, or my apartment, and sat down streaming. Well, after I fixed my green screen, which was broken for some reason. And after I checked my audio settings to be sort of okay. I hope they're alright. They were a bit on the fishy side for some reason. But that's what happens when you have literally 0 minutes to do stream prep. Sometimes! How are you today? I hope you're better than me. I'm stressed as balls. Stress balls. Oh, it's been a crazy, crazy couple of days. And today was no different. Oh, this bottle looks weird. A Lord of the Rings marathon. Yeah, that had to have taken a while. Was it the extended editions? In that case, that's literally the entire day. Of course. Why would it not be, right? Oh boy. For a minute there, I didn't actually think there was going to be a stream today because... Wow. Well... First off, I was in another city, which is 220 kilometers north of here, until about 3, and then I had to go home, or go back to my original workplace, which is another 220 kilometers, and there was a traffic jam on the way, where I got stuck for 20 minutes, there was some form of accident. So I was like, there's not going to be a stream today, I'm pretty sure. Then I came back to town and... it was packed with cars. I was getting nowhere. I was like, there's definitely not going to be a stream today because I'm going to miss my train. And this was a train that went 45 minutes later than my usual train. But I just made it. So I came into my apartment 5 minutes before stream time today. So I spent all of those 5 minutes basically just making sure everything was working and then started stream. Hello, Beats Turtle 605. I am doing well. How are you? There was too many T's and Z's in connection with each other right there. I feel I need to just sit here and breathe for a second. You got some shit down and now you're making a box. That sounds like a productive day. Or productive thing to do. So, anyway, I've got a very upset cat, so if there's any meowing, nothing I can do. I'm going to be leaving school soon and saw you were streaming, so I decided to stop by for some time. You're most welcome. You're awesome, dude. Or dudette, or whatever you identify as. Dude is just an expression of respect from my part. It has nothing to do with gender, really. Anyway, what we're gonna do today... Meow! Okay, you're a cat. No! Oh! Sorry, didn't catch that one. The order your messages showed up in makes this for a rather interesting story. Because, meow, boy! Anyway. So I've been doing a bit of stuff in the last few days. And I'm probably not gonna show you this because it looks like ass. Let's go somewhere else. Let's go someplace. There it is. Go here. And then let's go here. Yeah, there we go. Alright, so let's hop on over to Word Anvil. Void Soda, the best taste you will never taste. Indeed. So, as you can see, right here, I've been doing a rather large overhaul of my CSS. It is not done. It is not even a quarter done. But I'm working on it. It used to be basically just Galaxy Anvil with a few colors tweaked. Now it's an entirely new theme that I made myself from the ground up. And it's going to be awesome when it's done. It's really, what can you say, embraces the whole Outrun cyberpunk garish aesthetic, and I love it. It's awful and I love it. So that's what I've been working on the last few days, just making a new theme that I'm more happy with, that fits the aesthetic better. I've also actually been doing a fair amount of article work. Let us have a look on the development updates on the Discord and have a look of what I've been doing. That is... that is a fair few articles in the last week. I haven't written any new articles because that's work that I don't have time for, but I have been editing and clarifying things, and I did get the districts list done. I don't remember if I had that done last stream. I don't think so, because we were working on the map last stream. Where are the districts? There it is. This is the districts list over all the districts in Fusion City, and I just realized that this window is way too large. Can we shrink it down so you can see all of the things that I'm seeing? It's about... yeah, yes, there, that's where it is. Now I have the nice little box down here too. Hey Hefe!
Nice to see you, my bearded awesomeness.
The garlic? No, it's Garrick. Where the hell is it? There it is. Garrick. I don't think I've written that article. No, I have not. There's nothing written about that one. But it exists. Woo! I made it!
Invicta. Welcome.
Sorry, Invicta. Depending on if you're Roman or not. So, Garrick, not garlic. How far in can I zoom this? Garrick. Alright. Oops. Too far. There we go. Oh, so that's what I've been doing. What are we going to do today? Honestly. Oh, garlic, not Garrick. There you go. Honestly, I sat down and I just jumped into the stream. I have no idea what we're going to do today. But I had a plan. No, I didn't. That would be a lie. I did not have a plan. But I've been saying for probably 2 weeks straight, or maybe even 3 weeks, that I was going to do the mutation rules. So, since I have nothing else to do today, how about we jump right into that? All right? Plan? What's that? Indeed, exactly that. What even is a plan? Plans are for weaklings and people who do not world build. My question is, game related, I'm pretty sure I did create the article, but that is... Here's the question though. Because right now, I have a campaign rules article. It will now forever be known as garlic. Indeed. Not the place for vampires. No, the vampires will have to hang out somewhere else, where there are not a lot of garlic. Ah. So, I have campaign rules, right? Right there. For some reason, I want to point that way, because it's that way to me, but it's that way to you. This is greatly confusing. I should probably mirror my camera. Anyway. I have campaign rules, which is, which covers everything that isn't, you know, immediate. It's things like overtime stuff, such as experience points, right? Experience. And improving with experience. And also, by the way, Nina, you had an excellent point last time we played, so this here thing is your thing. Hidden skill checks and experience. Since you have to mark when you fail a skill in order to be able to improve that skill, there's a problem when there's a hidden skill check that the GM doesn't tell you the outcome of. Say you're trying to persuade someone, the GM might not tell you if you succeed. Or you're trying to hide, the GM might not tell you if you succeed. So if you fail, you don't know, and you can't place your little check mark, and you can't increase the skill at the end of the session. Oh, the terror, right? So, I made it so that the GM, whenever a player fails a hidden skill check, the GM should note it down and tell them at the end of the session. Thank you. Oh my god, the garlic destruction? Discussion! Well, I guess destruction kind of works too. Anyway. Why is that so huge, by the way? Is that that's probably an H4, right? That's an H4. Why is that so enormously huge? That's like ridiculous. If we change that to 1.0 EM, that's a little bit more reasonable. Actually, that's even more reasonable. Should be 1.1 maybe? That didn't change at all. Music is a bit too loud, by the way. Not that it isn't awesome. Even when I'm talking, because as you remember, I do have the ducking thing. So if I'm not saying anything, you should enjoy the music. Garlic destruction. I remember it like it was yesterday. Veteran flashback. All the garlic lost. Well, I guess I now have to have a garlic event sometime. Okay, you really like this? I am not happy with this. The margin at the bottom is too small and the margin at the top is good, but the text, it doesn't really pop. You see? It isn't too loud when you're talking, but when you stop, it's a punch in the ears. Okay, then give me a second and I shall drop it by another 3 decibels. Hopefully it should be a little better now. It's about half the volume right now. Okay, right, so the H5 needs to change. So let's go to the... This mic boom is right in the monitor thing here. So let's move that over there. The garlic district of Selenia rubs the garlic events. Oh, you people, you take the strangest things and run with them. It is amazing. And rubs the garlics. You know, it wouldn't surprise me if rubs was what you meant to say, because that's about as crazy as I expect from you people. You weird, weird people. You strange and wonderful things. Alright, so. I want to have... Oh hey, it showed up! Awesome! It remembered that I want this window. Look, my code, it's right over there. There. This is very difficult, remembering which direction is left and which is right when it's the other way around on the camera. It's really strange. Anyway. But I guess rubs works too. Nope, it rubs, it's canon now. That it is. That's how it works over here. So we can close this, because I'm gonna work in the code window. code windows are probably a little bit small for you, right? You can't really see this. And you... No, you can't. So, how about we do this instead, right? We do this.
And then we do...
code. Hello? You know what? Let's do this. While we're working on the code, let's do that. Okay? Look good, yes?
God, I hate this music function. I'm sorry, but even when you just take a breath, it goes up for half a second. Actually, that I can fix.
If you would only give me a second, I can make the hold, the release, a bit longer.
It unfortunately can't be longer than 1 second. I would have liked to have it at like 2.5 seconds or something like that, but I can't make it longer. Just remember that your left is always right, and your right is always wrong. That is not helping, surprisingly.
Yeah, okay. So, you can also do that, make music just a little bit not so loud.
Where was I? What was I gonna change before I got completely sidetracked? As always is the case.
I was going to change the H4, which in the CSS is H5.
Yes? Yes, it is.
Okay. So. It can keep being pink, it is Roboto condensed, it's bold. You know, font weight could just simply be bold. That is simpler to remember. Font size though, that's gonna change to 1.0em.
Howdy howdy, dragon love water.
That sounds like a love potion for dragons, which is pretty awesome.
It's better when it's this type of music, but when it was music like the last song, it was really like when your heart does that dump, dump, dump randomly.
Ah, I see. Well, that means it's a little bit too loud then. Also, I really wish I could make it longer. If the kickback, when I stop talking, would be longer, it wouldn't be as bad because the volume would slowly rise. I can't make it longer than a second, apparently, because OBS is a piece of crap. But it's all we have, and it's also free, so, you know, I give them a break.
Text transform uppercase, yes. Margin top, 5. Margin bottom should probably also be 5. And what else was I going to change? I think it only was the font size, right? Longer kickback would be better, yes. That response is a first. I've gotten so many funny ones. No one has told you before that is a dragon love potion, really?
That sounds highly unlikely, I doubt you. That is the first thing you should think of.
Alright, now. Oh crap, I did change the page. I have to reload the page. Oh boy. My net is so slow. So slow when I'm on... when I'm streaming. Because the upstream is... Hello? Oh, there you are. I was like, where's World Anvil? Hello? Okay, so, yeah, that looks way better. Question is now, though, does it just disappear in the mass? It kind of feels like it does. I think it would help with a larger top margin. So we make the top margin like 15 pixels instead. And see how that looks. So that it pops out from the text a little bit more. Yeah, that's better, that's better. Now you actually see there's a gap and there's a text. Now it doesn't just disappear in the mass of text anymore. Which reminds me, what the hell is the margin on the other ones? And none.
That might be a problem.
You should probably add a margin to them.
Whoops!
Is this using guild features? Good question. Yes, yes, I think it is. The CSS editing is a guild feature. I'm pretty sure it is anyway. Alright, so can you come back up here? I'm working on the code. So, yes. I'm gonna say yes. Hefe can probably correct me if I'm wrong, because Hefe knows everything. He has the beard, you know? CSS is guild. See, see, I told you. He's always right. You should listen to Hefe. And let's add a margin. Magrin? Magrin. That's a name. Margin bottom is going to be what? 5 pixels? Yes? This song is probably going to be a little bit loud, so I'm going to pull it down. You know what? Let's put this back at 5. It's going to be a bit loud now, but bear with me here. That should be better. Alright, so 5 pixels, the H2. This should also have the same margins to make things coherent. Padding bottom. Why does it have padding? The container and section BB codes, however, are Grandmaster tier. Yeah. Those I remember, if you're using containers and stuff, which I will do eventually. Actually, I do have one article where I use them. It's Fusion Achete. If you go look at World Emerald again, let's just move that up. If I go edit settlement here, we can look in the code, which is a little bit small right now, but if I do this, you'll be able to see here. Container. This thing here, I'm only using that to put a box around the text, and right now I'm remaking all my CSS, so I don't actually have anything set for this, so it's invisible. But eventually I will use it. And that is a Grandmaster and above feature. So where was I? Gini. No. There. Alright, thanks. I need to wait on being more consistent with writing stuff before I can justify getting a membership, but this will be fun to hang out with nonetheless. Yes! And, I mean, you can see it in action and see what it can actually do. Let me just show you something. Actually, let's put all of this into my World Anvil box. Like so. If I remove all my CSS, all of it, have a look what happens. Actually, this is a really bad article to show that on. Let's go to this one. View settlement. Here we go. Now watch what happens as I remove my CSS. That's what it looks like without the CSS. It's just white! It's a pretty nice theme, or theme, it's a pretty nice look, but doesn't quite fit the cyberpunk post-apocalypse vibe that I'm going for. I want more pink and garish. My eyes! Yeah, it's a little bit bright. I like the theme though. For another world, I would have almost preferred it. And thing is, I'm really tempted to use that white theme for one reason. Because I'm ordering art for Tinders of the Cataclysm. That's basically what my entire Patreon is all about. If you want to support the channel, by the way, there are several ways you can do that, and one of those ways is through Patreon, and the link is below. You can also donate bits, and you can subscribe to the channel. Or if you can't commit to, you know, monthly things, there's also coffee. Anyway, what that money is going to is art. So, art. My art is looking like this. This is the art style we're going for. This comic book black and white thing. And it would look so good in that white theme, wouldn't it? It would fit perfectly with that. But I have to pick one or the other. But this is the art style, and I'm using this because it's the, you know, I want to evoke that 80s comic book style for the art. So that's why I'm going with this, which is awesome. This is a Vindrol, by the way, one of the species in my setting. There are five species. It's the Droon, the Ilim, the Kuna, the Vindrol, and the Heshak. And this is a Vindrol. They're about 5-ish feet tall. So they're pretty small, but their ears are very long. Not that long. They're like a hand on a grown person. But, you know, compared to their body size, it looks comically huge. But they're pretty awesome. They're a descendant from the Fae, as a matter of fact. Anyway, I just wanted to show off the awesome art and also tell you why I would like the white theme. Where was I? I was here working on the CSS, right. So good! Yes, I know, right? I just realized I don't have to be at school till 12:30 because I have all the work I need to do here. Two of the classes I'm taking are self-paced and the other is online. The third class is at 12:30 is art. Art? Nice. They are famous for that. Thing is though, it doesn't actually spell like that. I do spell Fae like that. Oops. Oh, it did the thing. Oh, it did the thing. Come back. Here. I spell Fae with an A. Because it sounds better. You know, Fae. A. It's an A. It's not a Fee. It's not an E. I know. It's a linguist thing, but I know a lot of people spell Fae either with F-E-Y or F-A-E or even F-Ash, which is completely wrong. Ash, by the way, for the ones who don't know, is the letter I just typed in chat there. It's the squiggly A-E that is stuck together. Fae. They're famous for that. There you go. That's how you spell it. Correct. The E may be left over from Latin, I guess. How did you type that? Honestly, I'm on Linux. And in Linux, it's just Alt-G-R and the button. No, the button, sorry. I have a Swedish keyboard and I'm on Linux, so I'm not sure how I can tell you how to do that on a Windows machine on an American keyboard. So, but I can make all the fancy letters. I can make Thorn, I can make Ev, I can make Ash, I can even make the... Weh? No, I can't, sorry. But that's the Thorn, the Ev, and the Ash. All letters I actually use in my comlangs, by the way. I can't make Win though. I do miss Win. Win is a cool letter. Win is the letter that made the W sound, the W. And it's kind of like a wonky P or a D where you took the round part and just angled it upwards. That's a Win. It's a cool letter, you should check it out. But I can't make the Win because it's so unusual, not even on Linux you can just make it with a key press. Thorn and Ed are still used in Icelandic today. They represent the th sound, Thorn in thing, and thanks, the th sound, that's Thorn. And then the Ed is the voiced equivalent, like in thing, no, in this, that. You know, the voice, the sound. Today you learned. Back to the CSS. I'm using a keyboard with Swedish, Norwegian, and Danish stuff. Oh, yeah, so an Estonic? What the hell? What do you call your country in English? Estonic? Estnic? In Swedish, I would say Estnisk. But how do you say that in English? You can create your own fonts, so I wonder if you could set your keyboard Estonian. Yeah. Of course, I completely forgot about that one. Estonian, thank you. You can create your own fonts, so I wonder if you could set your keyboard up to type the symbols for a language you designed for your world. I think so, yes. I do have FontForge somewhere around here, but I haven't fiddled around with it because time. Time is not a thing I have. Right, we were working on the margins. Quit distracting me, chat. I'm just kidding. Never stop distracting me. It's fun. Where should I put this? Right there, I think. Hello? Music? Did you just perish for no reason? Okay, fine. We're going to play this. And we're going to play that. And then we're going to go next. Thank you. Weird. My keyboard doesn't actually have the Estonian stuff, just the Nordic. Are there any letters in Estonian that you need that you don't have on the Nordic one? I mean, you must have O and E, these letters, right? Although I recently saw a picture of one that had Swedish, Norwegian, Danish, and Estonian. They were also neatly separated by different colors. That's really cool. I have a similar thing, actually. I don't know if my camera is long enough to show this. What I'm gonna do is just do this. And also we're gonna switch up OBS to this. You can see the they do have the different versions of the letters. Really should clean my keyboard. So it does have several variants of the key that you can get with different key presses. It's weird. Hello, Lily. Welcome to the chat and sustain. Alright, we're back to the CSS. I was adding margins before I got so rudely. That one already has margins, right? Top, money, bottom. And mina mina. Awesome. All right. This I'm gonna. Let's see here. Let's go see. Let's go Swedish. Ha! Oh. Take Swedish out, put English in. That was happening today. CSS keyboard layouts and garlic destruction. Yeah, that's pretty accurate. Alright, so that's an H2. No, that's an H3. That's an H2. Or are these H1s? I think they're H1s. It's so weird because CSS and HTML speak different languages. So while this is an H1 in CSS, it's an H2 in HTML, which is real confusing. Time to see if I can destroy my keyboard, which is part of my Chromebook, so I'd be destroying the thing and get myself a better keyboard. You do know you can just change the keyboard layout, right? In the settings on your machine. That might be preferable to just breaking the thing. Sure, the keys might not actually type what you're pressing, but I haven't used a Chromebook, so I don't actually know what OS is on it. It's like Chrome OS or something, but there should be a setting somewhere for adding keyboard layouts, and you can add like Swedish, Finnish, whatever. Right, but this is such a mess to manipulate with CSS, so I'm just gonna remove this thing. Yeah, go again with the right and left. I'm just gonna remove this thing and remake it with my own block. I'm gonna make my own block for this, because this, oh, it really, really grinds my gears. Same with this. Fuel and vehicles. Work in progress. Yeah. Rations and hunting. Why is it called hunting? Oh, because there still is hunting, but you just use survival now. Alright, okay, cool. Shadow corruption. Here we are. Here's where... Wow, this was the longest roundabout to get to something I was trying to say in the beginning of the stream ever. We have been live for 42 minutes. And I tried to say this right at the beginning. It took us almost 40 minutes to get here. I am the best at being distracted. So before I get distracted again, what I was gonna say was, I wasn't sure if I was gonna put the mutation rules here in the campaign rules, or if I'm going to stick it in the article on mutations instead, and perhaps take everything from here and put it in the articles that relate to that stuff. Like, if you're interested in experience, you're going to be looking at skills, because skills is what you increase with experience. Sure, you can get psionics with experience as well, but then you could just have a pointer in the psionics article point to the skills article. And in the book, I'm probably gonna do that anyway. Just put the experience at the bottom of the skills chapter, right? But there's still things that really don't fit anywhere else, like offspring, or aging, or death of age. But mutations, I think I can put in the mutations article, the mutation rules, that is. Shadow corruption. See, here's the problem, because shadow corruption fits here. Are going so difficult. So I think I'm gonna do that. Words are hard. By the way, I've actually commissioned an artist to make me my first emote that's going to be used on this channel. And guess once what that emote's going to be. Put it in the mutation article and link that in the rules. Yes, or I could cover only having mutations and the mutations list in the mutations article and put the mutation rules, as in how do you acquire mutations after character creation, here. Because it is very closely linked to shadow corruption. Because shadow corruption is the one way you actually do get mutations. Oh, one of my favorite songs again. Void soda emote. Dang it, that's a really good idea. I'm gonna write that down. No, it's not a void soda emote. But that's a good idea. That's gonna be that's gonna be an alternative for when we get some more subs. Because you do know, you need sub points to get more emotes. I can only have one emote right now. But no, my first emote is going to be a words are hard emote, because it's freaking hard. I bleh all the time, so it's going to be a useful emote for you to spam when I can't get to the point and just gibber, like a gibberling. Oh, words, they're hard. Snork smash. Questionable. Because the thing is, While I do like very channel-specific emotes, I kind of want the emotes to have, you know, a universal use, so that you get something more out of subscribing to this channel than just an emote you can spam here. A words are hard emote is sort of universally useful for any streamer that just mumbles and can't get to what they're trying to say. So you can use that emote on other channels if you subscribe here. That's kind of my point. So that's how most of my emotes are going to be. They're going to be very, very relevant to this channel, but also universal, right? They're going to be very me, but useful everywhere. Or everywhere, but most places. That's my goal anywhere. Anyway. Actually, one of the absolute best emotes that have ever been made. I need a distracted emote. Yes, I do. Oh. Actually, one of the best emotes ever made is the squid star that I put in chat right now. It is the ultimate. It's so useful. It's from Squiddish, but it's so useful. You can use it anywhere and everyone just understands that it means you tried. It's such a good emote. Anyway. Yes, I definitely need a distracted emote. You know what? Actually, I'm gonna go to my notepad and get utterly distracted from what I was doing in order to make a note about me needing a distracted emote. Oh. So, let's call this streams and give it a rich razzleberry chloror 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 color. Christ, why are words so hard? Where is it? There it is. Save changes. Go back to the notebook. Lololololo. Streams. Page. Emotes. So we need words are hard. That's my idea. We need also a not sure if intended, also my idea, but Ademol inspired it. Which keyboard should I use? German, Irish, or Icelandic? Stupid question. Icelandic, obviously. It's the most awesome of all the keyboards. We need a void soda. Which was, if I'm not wrong, Beats Turtle, right? No. The Void Soda was Delian. And we also need a distracted emote. Which is Nina. No, it was you. Alright, so I guess Delian just asked what it was. Where is it? I'm looking through chat here and I got distracted. I'm a bit late. Katoblen! One day I will manage to pronounce your name without stuttering. But Kato Blepon Dra. Welcome. Kato. Kato. I guess it's Kato in English. It's easier. Yes, it is. But Kato Blepondra is funnier because I stumble on it. Anyway, so. So the void soda is Beats Turtle. Am I spelling this right? Beats Turtle 605. There we go. And there's actually another thing I'm going to make on World Anvil, which is list of references. Because there is a ton of references in Cinders of the Cataclysm and Dark Shadows. And I have a feeling that if it gains any kind of following, like a community around the game, which I hope it won't just publish and disappear into the void, because I would love for people to enjoy this system and these settings. There are going to be people who notice these references and will start compiling a list for them. And it would be really handy if I knew what references I put in, because I put in a lot already, and it would be really nice if I had a list of which ones I put in before I forget. So I'm gonna do that. Not right now, but someday. Compile a list of references. Are you creating your own system from scratch? Yes, I am. Well, it's not entirely true. The thing is, you never start from scratch with a system. You always base it upon something, and then you modify it until it's not recognizable anymore. You kind of have a starting point. Now, a lot of people have like D&D as their starting point, and then they modify it. I started with a very obscure system that I actually helped co-create way back. It was probably back in... Let's see, let's count back. It was likely around 2002 or 2004. Around there. I'm not sure. Don't quote me on this. But a guy on a forum called Rollspel.nu, which is just role-playing or RPGs for Swedes, basically. It's a Swedish channel or forum. Was working on a system that he called the D10 system. And I had some input on that. We had a big bit of back and forth. I mean, it's 100 years ago, so he's probably forgotten me by now, but I remember because I'm weird like that. And like 10 years later, which is about what, five or six years back now, I got my hands on his RPG that he'd written, which is called Vestmark. Which is a Swedish role-playing game, which is set in a fable-like saga, folklore setting. It's a really cute game. And I read through it, and I did like the setting, but not enough to really play in it. But I loved his system. The system he had devised was really, really great. Thing is, I got my hand on like the third edition of the game, which was the first commercially published one. And he's moved on to publish several updates to the rule system he designed for Vestmark. He kind of decoupled it from Vestmark and continued developing it. So the version I had was like version 0.9 or something. And he had gone on to make like version 3, 4, 5. So it's very different now. But the version he did, the 0.9, was very similar to the one we talked about on the forum. And I kind of... That's what I used as a basis for the CD10 system. CD10, by the way, just means Selenia D10 system. It's very simple that way. Because... It is a system that can be used for any setting, but it's primarily designed to be used with the Selenia settings, which are Cinders of the Cataclysm and Dark Shadows. And it's a narratively focused system with no base attributes and all that jazz. You've heard me explain this like 1,000 times, but if you want it explained again, please let me know, because I'll gladly talk about my system for hours on end. But Vestmark is my inspiration and the basis upon which I built Selenia, right? Or CD10, sorry. Words. So yes, I am indeed creating my system from basically scratch. It has grown so much since the days where I started with it. And I mean, I've been working on this for 18, soon to be 19 years. Mainly Dark Shadows, which is my feudal fantasy setting. It started out as a port of this game, which is Mutant, as you would say in England, 2089, which is a Swedish role-playing game. And yes, this is the entire game. Swedish role-playing games are very, very simple. They give you a world and some framework rules, and then the rest is up to you. Which is why CD10 looks the way it does, because this is what I grew up with, these tiny, really simple role-playing games. where you focus on the experience and the character and all that, rather than focusing on, you know, mechanics. And it started as a port of this to a fantasy world. And then we started developing our own rules, and the setting grew, and blah blah blah, and eventually I settled on the D10 system. Which is now very close to being completely done. I'm running the alpha test right now, and it's going well. And if I can find some time to edit the sessions together, it will be on the YouTubes pretty soon. The first session, anyway. The session 0 is already on the YouTubes, but session 1 will be out sometime in the coming 2 weeks, hopefully. God, I can talk a lot, can't I? I hope you enjoy my history blabbering, because I do. It would be great if you did too. If you don't, tell me to shut up, and I'll shut up and do something useful with my life. This is useful, by the way. You can't convince me otherwise. This music is adorable. Insert distraction emote placeholder. Yes. Alright. So. Let's get working on the mutations, shall we? Where was I with that? Here. Did they fix the focus mode thing, by the way? They did not. It's still wonky. How do I turn this off? There. Right. Hold on a second. Did Dimmy disable the what you see is what you get editor? Or is it just not active for a generic article? Must science. Yeah, he must have. Is it still active for the footer, though? Footer? No? Why isn't it showing? Hefe? Help! Why is the what you see is what you get thing not showing? Does it not work in Firefox, maybe? I use Chrome for my day-to-day stuff, but for Wild Animal I use Firefox, because Chrome has a sort of bug where text boxes get enormously slow when there's a lot of text in them. So like scrolling like this would take 5-10 seconds for it to just chop down. It drove me nuts, so that's why I'm doing World Anvil on Firefox. Alright, so where was I? Mutations, yes. You know, we should probably make this easier somehow. Oh, whatever. Mutations. Getting mutations. So my idea is, you know, I could make this real simple. My idea is that when you receive shadow corruption from being exposed, let's go to the campaign rules. I can show you. Hello, search. Thank you. Don't be so slow. Chat, did you die? Can someone poke Hefe for me? Where are we? There. Shadow corruption. What the hell? Why do these look so different? There is Heffy. Hi. So, do you know if Dimi deactivated the what you see is what you get editor? Or does it just not work in Firefox? Yes, it is you and your glorious beard that I'm looking for. These look so different. There's something wrong here. I'm getting distracted again, so let's get distracted. What is this? This is an H3, and this is what? An H2. The H2 looks smaller than the H3. This must be remedied! I think it's still disabled for now. Okay. Alright. Fair enough. I was just wondering if I was going crazy or something. Tobin? That's Toblin, but yes. That me. I think I messed up. Well, that does happen. What did you do? I changed this to robot. Alright, I have to actually double click. Roboto. Condensed. No. Let's keep that name pro. Everything is in German! Well, if you don't know German, that's a problem. Okay, so font, weight, bold. That does help a little bit. I do feel I need to have font size, like 1.4 em, 1.6. That's a little bigger. Because it looks so small. I don't like that the fonts are different. So, you know what? I'm gonna do this. The H2. Oh, did you change the entire computer to German instead of getting a keyboard language? That sounds like a problem. You should probably not have done that. User CSS H2, right? So, family is Maven. Hold on. I have two H2s. Why do I have two H2s? I should probably not have two H2s. They're gonna interfere with each other. Hello? Go away. How have I not caught this before? Weird. Hello? Oh, the dot disappeared there. That's where I wanted. That's what I wanted it to look like. Why did I break it so catastrophically then? That's so much better. That explains why. Alright, there we go. There we go. I fixed it. He's not broken anymore. Now, stop being distracted and go to the mutations. Right, so, mutations. How do I get anything done? That is a question no one really knows the answer to. So, my idea was that you get shadow corruption, right? And that can kill you. And you also make a physical save on it. And I was thinking that if you fail your physical save, you get to roll on a mutation table, or I make it real simple, you roll a die, and if it lands on 0, which is about 10% chance, right? Because a D10. Yes, the 0 on a D10 is 0 in CD10, not 10. It clearly says 0. if you roll a zero, you get a mutation and you get to roll on the mutation table, right? Which is in the mutation article, or going to be. I'm going to add it eventually. That's how I'm thinking it's going to work. Nice. So, if you do not believe me, this is a D10, right? And behold, the zero. It's clearly a zero. And I adopted that for CD10. Anyway, I think that's about the easiest way to do it. You fail your shadow corruption check, which means you get shadow sickness, and you also roll again. And if you get a zero, you roll on the mutation table, and you get a mutation, either a gift or a defect, right? Because the shadow is what actually corrupts you. While in most games it would be something like radiation or toxins, but here it's the shadow. The remnants of shadow is what corrupts you. That's actually a really simple way to do it, and it gives a real chance of actually getting mutation. Because I've played other games where there are mutations, and you can pick mutations as you create your character, and you can technically get mutations during gameplay, but the chance is so infinitesimally small that it barely ever happens. Having a 10% chance of getting mutated when corrupted sounds fairly reasonable to me. It's a small chance, but it's bigger than, like, what, 0.5%? Actually, now that I actually have the rulebooks here from Mutant, it actually does have mutation rules, so let's see what the game says. Hold on. I am holding on. Why shall I hold on? What am I holding on to? Let me know. I'm feeling a bit lost here. How do I get those letters with the dots on top of them? Do you know how to make a diuresis? I don't know how to do that on an American keyboard, but it's basically this character. You do that, and then another letter, like O, A, E, I, etc. You will get dots over it, like an I, or an E, or an O, which in Swedish would be called Ö. That's how you do it. Really? There are no rules about getting mutations? Calm the spam, indeed. I'm actually surprised it didn't nick you for the first time you did it. Because Moobot did not like excess letters and weird symbols. It gets really upset. Okay, so there are actually no rules for mutations in this book. It's probably in the world book then. Honestly, I don't understand why they did multiple books. Come on, this is like, what is it, 80 pages? 60 pages. And then they made a world book with all the settings things in it, and that is 50 pages. Like, why? Why do you separate them? You could have put them both in one and the same. Alright, the reference index. Mutations. Really? I'm sure I've seen it somewhere. Excuse me, but I'm getting hung up on this crap. I know there's something for getting mutations during the game. Maybe that's just what our GM homebrewed. That is a possibility, because I remember us getting mutations during the game, but the chance was so small it was barely worth mentioning. Oh, there it is! Alright, so what was it? For every hour you are in an extremely radiated area, you risk mutation. The risk is 10% minus your physical stat per day, always 1% at least. And most characters would have a physical stat of over like 10. So it would literally be 1% per day, which is really nothing. That's real small. The what is what now? Why the Y is Z now? I'm not sure what you mean by that, but okay. Anyway, holy crap. So getting mutations. If you receive at least a serious wound, this is going to be italicized. Yeah. Muskies is not the wikis. Huh? So what you're trying to say is that your Y key is now a Z. I think you done fucked up somewhere. Okay, so if you receive at least a serious wound from Shadow Corruption, see above, you must roll a mutation check. Zess. I kind of like that when you say yes, it's now Zez. It's funny. Changing language in the keyword may change the position for the letters and symbols. Yes, it can. But it should be your W that is a Z. Because I know French keyboards have, instead of QWERTY, they have AZERTY, which A-Z-E-R-T-Y instead of Q-W-E-R-T-Y. I don't know why. You must roll. Oh, whoops. I accidentally brought that with me. If you receive at least a serious wound from the Shadow Corruption, see above, you must roll a mutation check. A mutation check is performed by rolling a D10. And if you roll, here's a question. Should I make it an even larger chance of getting a mutation? If you roll a 9, you get a gift. If you roll a 0, you get a defect. Or shall I just have you roll a 0 and then you get to roll if you get a gift or a defect? There's a lot of rolls here. It would be easier if I just had a determiner, like you get a defect or you get a gift. Thing is, if I do that, it is now suddenly 20% chance of getting something if you get a Shadow Corruption. That's 1 in 5. It could be fun though. If it is a tangible chance of getting mutated, people would probably fear corrupted areas even more. I think I'm gonna do that. I think I'm just gonna make it a 20% chance of getting mutated, either good or bad, if you get a serious wound from corruption. Yeah, that's what I'm gonna do. If you roll a 9, you develop a beneficial mutation gift. And we're gonna become mutants, aren't we? Only if you step into corrupted areas. And only if you stay there for long enough to actually get seriously corrupted. Dame has an A-class rating. You can't F that up for her. Oh my god. Indeed, she's an A2, isn't she? I think she's an A2. Mufasa, all the light touches is ours. But what's that dark area over there? You must never go there. Indeed. That's called Husqvarna. Oh, wow, sorry, that was a very Swedish joke. And not even a Swedish joke, that was a very Smolandian joke. Thinks of the possibility of mutating Dame. Hey, Mildred? No, bad girl. Cease. You develop a beneficial mutation, and if you roll a 0, you develop a dead defect. Wow, that was a small unjoke indeed. I know. I'm sorry. Who is Dame? Dame is one of the characters in the Cinders of the Cataclysm alpha test. She's a rich brat who moonlights as a private investigator, and she is played by Ina. And Mildred is her protectee. Basically, Mildred is adopted by Dame, mostly as a means to get back on her dad, rather than actually taking care of a child. And Mildred is a seriously disturbed young lady. Who is also the protege of a seriously shady person who goes by the name of Shady Frank, who is a cybernetic surgeon. Yeah, it's a fucked up party. I love them though. They're creepy, but effective. Shady Frank, indeed. Shady Frank made it into becoming an NPC, an actual, official, legitimate NPC. Shady Frank is actually Chat's... It's not entirely Chat's creation. Chat is responsible for making him popular. Shady Frank was someone I referred to just off the top of my head when I did the cybernetics rules. During one of the streams 3 or 4 months back, I explained the way that different clinics had different propensity to report you to the authorities if you try to install restricted hardware or wetware, sorry. And I made a reference to, I want to install this Fuck Blaster 9000, but they're going to report me to the authorities, so I'm going to go to Shady Frank on the corner. And Chat just ran with that, so now he's an actual legit NPC. It happens. Chat does that a lot. We have a lot of things that Chat has created. Like Shady Frank, Void Soda, all of those things. I love it. It's one of the parts that's so amazing of streaming this stuff. You must then roll on the...
Enjoy your stay,
Dragon Love Water. I'm gonna call you Dragon Love Potion because it's much more funny. So you are now the Dragon Love Potion. Thank you for the follow. Appreciate it. You must then roll on the respective mutations list to see which mutation you develop. See the mutations. Mutations article for those lists. That is so easy. I was expecting to be here all day designing these rules, and they're just like, nah, you roll a d10 and done. Had the joy of sketching Shady Frank. Indeed you did. Mutations. Article. Let's move the article into this thing here. Press. Yes. Like so. Have changes. load. Did you shade him? He did, actually. Where are we? Shadow corruption, getting mutations, and there we go. So easy. I rolled an 8. Well, you made it. You're not corrupted. Or mutated, sorry. You might still be corrupted. Now we can remove that. Have changes. Actually, let me see if I can find that picture somewhere. I think I have Shady Frank somewhere. No? Thought I did. Whoops. Good thing I can spell. Alright, so. It is somewhere over the rainbow, way up high. There's the arm. Oh my god, there is so much talk of Shady Frank. I'm impressed, honestly. I had no idea people talked this much about Shady Frank. There it is. Alright, so let's see if I can show you this. This is Shady Frank. He is a disgusting goat man. Oh, the awesomeness that is chat. Oh. I even have a link for that. That's the stream where Shady Frank was actually born. Okay, so, distractions. Didn't know that you were on tubes. But see, that is why you push that little follow button. That way you will get a notification when I'm on so you don't miss it. Just a hot tip. That's what I get for disabling all of those notifications. Well, yeah, that's on you.
But welcome to the stream. Hope you enjoy.
So, now we have removed the work in progress on that one. And that is under Shadow Corruption, yes.
Perfect. Correct. Just the way I want it.
Now we go to the Mutations article and have a look. Defects table, and yeah, that we're gonna have that. Here's a question though, how did I design this? Sad face. Oh, or sad Pepe, I suppose. Alright, so character creation. If your character is a mutant, they were born a mutant or were exposed to greatness, blah 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 blah. Shadow corruption is the only way to achieve viable mutations in an adult subject. Gifts and defects. Mutations are divided into benevolent alterations called gifts and disadvantageous alterations called defects. When creating mutated character, first choose if they are mutated from birth or the result of an event in your adult life. Then you get to pick one gift for each role you make on the defects table. See below. Right, that's why I only made the defects table, because you get to pick a good mutation and you must roll on the defects table. But that is during character creation. If you get mutated later in life, there's gonna be two tables, one for gifts and one for defects. So I'm gonna have to make an gifts table as well. Also, these are really ugly. What did I call these? They're the skill trait value item title stat block template. Yeah, it's this one. Let's go back to our code and find the 314. No, that's not the one. Design it well. Got up a few hours ago, trying to figure out what I want to do before I get to work. Maybe some breakfast, get some chores down, and bills out of the way. Sounds like a solid start, my friend. This is the stat block, yes? No? Or is it? Stat block, template, CD10, traits, and skills. Traits and skills. Oh. I haven't styled that one. Which means it goes for... It goes under the stat block one only. Stat block. There's six of them. So it is this one then. Okay. The music was perfect for that. Welcome to the sentient playlist. But why is it so non-transparent? It is a linear gradient between darkest, light red, and darkest. And it is the transparent, not the light red. Border color should probably not be transparent though, or should it? Let's have a look at how it looks without the transparency. That is garish as balls. Not do that. Also, I apparently broke something because these... Change. Let's take the CSS here and put it here. That block. I know you're here. There you are. The border color is light red transparent. That makes sense. Background is the linear gradient. As we can clearly see, it goes from dark to light to dark. Well, you can't see it, but now you can. It's from dark to light to dark. Border is 1 pixel solid. Border radius has rounded corners on the opposite side, the top right, bottom left. But what doesn't make sense is why there are two border colors. Doesn't need to be two. It's enough with one. And the border on the left is thicker. But what is my question here is why they are so untransparent when they're clearly using the transparent color? Is there something wrong in my color definitions? Border color, more border colors to the people. Ah, very funny. So the darkest and the darker than the light red, they're all at 25 opacity. They should be more transparent than this. Oh, I think it's because this one isn't transparent. Because this is mid-transparent. If I make this actually transparent, this is the page element, by the way, which is the thing here. This is the page element. This, if I make the background here more transparent, they should look more transparent. Let us try that one. Yeah, now they're more transparent. That was the problem. Now the question is, does that make this unreadable because of the lines? I don't think so. The lines are pretty dark. I do have an article that I can test with this, which is Fusion City. Oh wow, that's Dark Shadows. Wrong! Save for now. Let's go to the homepage. Oops, I'm debating on whether I should continue playing as Mildred. You have started playing as Mildred. You should continue playing as Mildred. So there is nothing to debate. Do it! Obviously. So, Fusion City, this article. Let's have a read. Well, this looks okay. It doesn't look too messy, and the lines are dark enough. All jokes aside though, why would you want to not play Mildred? What is your motivation not to? Why would you stop playing her? Are you not happy with your character? Okay. I want to make a table here, but for now I think I'm just going to make a list, because a list is much easier. Oh, I forgot. Let's reload this. Take the CSS and save it in the editor so I don't lose it. Thank you. Editing. Notebook. Do it, Anakin. Indeed. Glad someone got that reference. Not that it's not a very, very popular reference that everyone uses all the time, but shush. So, oh right, I was gonna remake the defects. That's what I was gonna do. Let's do that. Honestly, why wouldn't we do that? Because that way we can actually make a defects list, because now we have like three defects. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, five. We have five instead of four, but you know, you get the idea. Lentus medulla. Also known as slow healing. Gelatinous blood. So, I'm gonna leave these as they are. Or am I? No, I'm not going to. Because I'm gonna have to update the blocks. We're gonna go to stat blocks. Are you writing up a novel there, Lily, or did you not hear my question? Because I'm genuinely curious. Oh, there it is. See? There it is. Feel that I'm going down a common path that I would like to steer away from in regards to being a player and don't want to repeat this. Okay, what path is that? Hi Nosk. How we get Nosk? Sentient playlist strikes again. I made them with traits and skills, right? I look at mutations. Traits and skills. So, traits and skills, new sheet. We're going to break disfigurement out into several blocks instead of just one. This is going to be the basic disfigurement. I just created a new one instead of editing the one that already exists. Why did I do this? I am stupid. Disfigurement, edit, path of a crazed character, which begs the question of why did I decide to make Mildred in the first place? Ah, I see what you mean, okay. The thing is, characters don't have to be the way you designed them in the beginning. And bear with me here. What I mean is, A character can evolve in a different direction than you intended initially because you feel that it doesn't really work out, it doesn't fit the setting, it doesn't fit the party, etc., etc. For instance, Jorik, who I played in Adventures of the Windswift with the great GM, how to be a great GM, he was going to be much more of a disconnected or a he was going to be more of a non-empathic asshole than he turned out to be. He kind of just became a very passionate soul once some event happened. Basically, he was a tool, and I don't mean that in the stupid sense. I mean it that he was, in his mind, he was nothing more than a tool made by the Order of the Hastari in order to defeat dragon worshippers and keep the dragons from returning. That was his identity. But when the Order collapsed and turned out to be a fraud, and being dragon collaborators themselves, that identity was taken from him, and he suddenly didn't know who he was, and his real personality emerged, which was a very passionate and empathic and caring character. And I mean, you can do kind of the same thing, because as I was playing Jorik, I didn't really feel the disconnected, asshole-y type of character. He was a bit stiff, sure. But I couldn't really settle into the character, so I changed him, and when this event happened, it was a really good moment to change his personality. And you can kind of do the same thing with Mildred. She is crazed, she is a bit unhinged, she is a bit emotionally unstable, and she's probably above all alone, because she has not made a real connection with anyone. That doesn't mean she has to be a gimmick. Yeah. From our first session together, I think you tried too hard to play on the gimmick part of her, and you kind of hung her whole personality on her being a gimmick. I think you should tone down the gimmick and play her like a normal person and choose your moments where her emotional instability and weird empathy can be more appropriate. For instance, like, she can be a pretty morose character for the most part. She doesn't have to be a downer, but she can be pretty Vulcan, if you wish. She's pretty logical because emotions scare her, because emotions are usually negative, right? So she tends to stick to being emotionally disconnected from things, which is easy when you're a Vindral, because the Vindral are emotionally disconnected to begin with, but she's even more so, which makes her kind of stiff, kind of robotic. Except if she's pressured, or if she twists into the second personality, which could be the other way around. It could be a very emotional person who has outbursts, who has violent outbursts when she gets pressured. Like, you end up in a combat situation, she gets stressed. You could have something that just bursts out and she becomes real violent for a second, and then she, you know, finds her composure again and retreats back into her shell. You could go that route, which is a more believable character than someone who just does weird antics. I mean, I'm not telling you how to play your character, I'm just giving you advice here. That's one way to do it, how to explore this broken character. And I don't mean that as a, you know, gameplay broken, but as a broken person. It's one way to do it. Because I felt a little bit that she was... You were hinging her entire personality on the gimmick, which made her not feeling real. She felt more like a comic relief than a real character. And I think if you delve deeper into this emotional thing and had it happen in situations that are appropriate, it would work better. Because I still like the concept of the character. The character background and the way she's grown up and all of that stuff feels compelling. So it's just a challenge for you to actually portray it. And by the way, I don't judge in any way. We are all playing role-playing games to evolve and become better role players and better character portrayers, whatever. And it's fun. I like evolving as a role player, and I hope you do too. I think I know how I want to approach this. Good. Glad to hear it. Alright, so, disfigurement. Your mutations have all to do cosmetically. Your skin is pale, it's a pale, sickly yellow color with dark splotches on it. Your gums are retracted, making your teeth long and scary looking. Your eyes are sunken. In social situations, you are at a -2 modifier, internal modifier, for social interaction. And, I mean, as adventure goes on, I will put Dame and Mildred into situations that might actually make them bond. Opportunities they haven't had before due to how their lives look. Exactly. Might be good for Dame too. Yeah, she might become less of a stuck-up asshole. Or less selfish, I suppose. Because that's her challenge, getting out of that I'm a loner, I'm a selfish loner person. It's a good character journey to have someone accept people into their lives and stuff. Eh, like it. Character development, yay! Okay. So that's the one. Excess body odor. Oh, did I have... Yes, mutation defect. Cool. Dame isn't a loner, she likes people. People are very useful. I didn't mean that. I meant she's a loner as in she doesn't need anyone else. He's used to being self-sufficient. That's what I meant with loner. Not a loner as in she doesn't like people. I meant more professionally. I work alone. Do you still have -2 if you're talking to another mutated person? Possibly. It depends on how the person is mutated. I mean, there are very many different mutations, and as I said, some of them are beneficial. If you have someone who has photosynthetic skin, for instance, he might react just as badly to you as anyone else. But if you run into a band of mutants out in the wastelands, they might not care that you're disfigured, because so are they. Everything in CD10 is a recommendation. Like, the rules say how this should be played in most cases. But it is always, always up to the GM to modify everything to fit the narrative. That is why so many of the rules have recommendations rather than strict rules. It is there to help you as a GM to make a judgment call on the spot for the situation. It is not there to tell you this is the way it's always supposed to be. So the -2 modifier might take effect in, you know, most situations, but not when you meet another mutant. There is no raw in CD10. That's what I'm trying to say. There is no rules as written, because it isn't a tactical system. It is not inherently dependent on balance. It is the GM's interpretation of the rules. That is the rule. That's how it works. Yeah. And that's because CD10 approaches roleplaying in a different direction than D&D does. D&D and Pathfinder by extension are both designed as tactical simulations with roleplaying tacked on top. They're originally dungeon crawls. And that legacy is still carried along into the game today, which means they're very encounter focused. And when you have something that is that complex as a tactical simulation, you must have raw rules as written, because you must have a clear rule that always applies, because the challenge is as much to the character with dice rolls as it is to you as a role player. CD10 is an alternate experience role-playing game. It sits somewhere in between the tactical simulation and the freeform storytelling game. It's more towards the freeform storytelling game, but there still are rules and still are dice roll. So it is not as important the rules as written as the GM decide what is best for the narrative and the situation and the tension right now. So yeah. Mutation, defect, disfigurement. I feel like there's a lot of different ways to change and develop your character while halfway through the campaign, to be honest. Yeah, especially when we come to things like personality and stuff. In D&D, it might be quite difficult to change the direction of your character without, like, multi-classing if we're talking stats-wise, but changing your personality really isn't that hard. Unless it means going from, like, lawful good to chaotic evil. Probably still could do that, but the mechanics aren't really there for it, and I hate alignments with a passion anyway, so don't do that. Body odor. My skill as a role player definitely wasn't as strong as it is now when I started, and my character was a generic, almost NPC-like compared to the other players, including the GM in skill. That's the fun part, when you really start exploring the role-playing side of role-playing games. I remember, Lily, you said something during session 1 where you said you've never been this immersed in a session ever. You'd played for 3 hours and there hadn't been a single combat role, and you felt that was very unique. Do I remember that correct? Yes, okay. Yeah, and if you're coming from a D&D space, because D&D kind of, as it is constructed, it kind of encourages that encounter way of being a GM. If you just read it, if you're a new GM and you read the rules, you easily get the image or the picture in your head that this is a computer role-playing game where you need to defeat enemies to get gold and get loot and get experience, right? So it gets very encounter-focused, and the role-playing kind of falls by the wayside and it becomes a side thing. I'm not saying that all groups do that, because I know there are rules that do some serious role-playing in D&D, but I have the feeling that a new GM starting with D&D might get that idea. Whereas a system as CD10 constantly pushes you as a GM into situations where you must think of the narrative. What is the tension right now? What is best for the narrative? Is it best for the narrative for them to defeat this big bad evil guy? It doesn't really have that because of the system. Or is it best for him to escape? I mean, you always think about the narrative, and you're even encouraged to fudge certain dice rolls to fit the narrative. You're never going to railroad your players, and you're never going to change an outcome unless it's for a better experience. So I guess what you can say is CD10 encourages you to use the dice as a guideline, not as rules. If the difference between +1 or +2 is more tension, reduce it by 1. That's how CD10 is meant to be played. So it's very, very heavy on the GM, so to speak. I develop and grown as a player, and I have done stuff over time to turn him into a real living person, both with faults and strengths. I played up his slaminess and emphasized recently his dwarven, conniving greediness against his dwarven honor and respect. See, that's fun. I mean, I've been role-playing for 25 years, probably. Let's just say I did not roleplay the way I do now back then. Not at all. I don't think I spoke in character once during my first 6 years of playing. I was a puppeteer. I was I had a character on the table, so we were playing Theater of the Mind with no figurines and stuff like that, or figures, or what do you call them, minis? We only had Theater of the Mind, but I was still the puppeteer. I was controlling my character. He does. He walks. He says. Or she, for that matter. I did play a couple of girls. I never identified and never really sat down and thought, how would my character react in this situation and what would he say? I never attempted to characterize my character when I was speaking. But that grew over time, and as I went from role-playing group to role-playing group, I started GMing more, which means I was suddenly portraying NPCs a lot more as a GM rather than a player, and that's where I learned to personify someone, which I then brought back into my role-playing as I started role-playing. So it's a growing experience for everyone, and it's fun. I had a real heart-to-heart moment talking with the other party members and doing something that would have been gross violation of privacy by reading a fellow party member's mind while they were asleep. Ooh. The fact that I even asked the other NPC, the other PCs had an emotional, moral breakdown because of it really enhanced and elicited a wow from the other players in the game that I previously definitely never had before. Toops the TTRPG counselor. Indeed. I mean, as I said, I've been playing for 25 years. I must have learned something in those years, I hope. So my fellow players at the table, figuratively speaking, definitely pulled me up to their ranks over the month. That's nice. So glad to hear that. It's a happy story. Okay, excess body odor. You smell strongly and most people don't like it. Kuna may find themselves nauseated by the smell. In social situations, this may take the form of a minus one modifier to social social interaction. Type mutation defect, and it is a mutation defect disfigurement. In space.
JT in space.
Now,
I should probably edit this article.
Awesome to hear, Sasha. Exactly. Awesome to hear. I love it.
Sounds awesome.
After this one, I think it's gonna be Balaha. I'm gonna have to sort these eventually. Because now they will not be sorted by alphabetical order. I'm just gonna put them in. So they're all in one space and I'll sort them later. Who you play dictate a lot about how I play. Like you say, you become inspired to play like your TRPG group members. That's also true. If you have a bunch of rabid murder hobos, you will probably become a rabid murder hobo. Dang it, it's almost time to end the stream, but I'm having so much fun, so I think I'm gonna keep going.
Do you feel it? Would you like to continue?
Or do you have other, more important things that you need to do? Skin flakes.
Ugh, disgusting.
The show must go on! Continue! Alright, I hear you.
We're going to continue then.
Skin flakes. Your skin produces skin cells at an alarming rate, and the skin falls off you in sheets and flakes. Most people find this unsettling and disgusting. If you end up in a social situation where clothes cannot hide your flakiness, apply a negative one modifier to the social situation. Mutation defect? Mutation disfigurement? Boom diada, and that is a 21... 83, 42.
plaque. When I used to play with murder hobos and more commonplace players, I thought to myself every session, I would rather be playing video games, or what's the difference between playing this and video games, to be honest?
I mean, okay. It's no secret I don't like D&D and Pathfinder and games of that ilk. So I harp on about that a lot. Anyone who's talked with me about RPGs for any length of time will know this. I respect that D&D exists and it has a huge following and there are people who like it, but it is not for me. And precisely for that reason you said right there, I'd rather be playing a video game. If I want to do battle slashing murder hoboing, or okay, that's this part of me. What I mean is, if I want to go out and defeat monsters for XP and loot, which is what a lot of D&D sort of devolves into as combat begins, I'd rather play Diablo, or Torchlight, or some other action RPG. Because for me personally, when I play D&D, I can be super immersed in the story and what is going on. I mean, I played with How to Be a Great GM, Guy, so he's a great GM, obviously. But the second he said, roll for initiative, it felt like everyone just dropped the roleplay and it became a disembodied tactical simulation where everyone was just trying to exploit the system to their maximum in order to win. It became a game rather than a role-playing session. And as soon as the battle was over and we got out of combat rounds, the role-playing just settled back in. And that is something I want to avoid with CD10. Combat should be just as immersive and just as roleplay heavy, or narrative, I suppose you could say, as non-combat. So my number one goal for that is removing hit points and make a more diffuse wound system. So you roleplay your wounds and you are seriously wounded. It is a more immersive way to write, to say it, than I lost 6 hit points. And it's very, very quick. The system is quick. Doing combat rounds is very fast. You can stay immersed and engaged. And the combat is very short because it never lasts very long due to it being a very lethal system. It's usually over after 3-4 turns or something like that. That's my goal with CD10. Okay, let's go back to reading chat. Holy crap. I'm just sitting here having you on in the background, and you know I never tire of hearing your voice, except possibly when you talk about cars, because I understand nothing. Yeah, those types of RPG sessions are more like games, like Eldritch games and such, tabletop games they are. Mm-hmm. I do play D&D, but our GM and our group's playstyle definitely leans more toward very heavy RP. But it takes a very special GM and a very special player to create a group dynamic that contributes to that end. Yes, especially when you have a system that works against you. I would argue that a system like Pathfinder, first edition, does work against you when it comes to role-playing because of how much maths and dice rolling you have to do. You really have to step back and think tactically about the situation in terms of game mechanics rather than think, what would my character do? That's, I think, is the biggest difference between combat in, say, Pathfinder and D&D and CD10. In CD10, you don't have a system to abuse, or maximize, I suppose I should say. You don't think in terms of game mechanics. You think in terms of, what would my character do here to survive? Am I going to run over to that cover to take cover in order to not be shot? Or should I... is it time to pop down and reload because I'm almost out of bullets? Or, I mean, you think much more like you would in real life if you were in a combat situation, barring panic, obviously. But it becomes more natural to act in combat in CD10. You don't need to know the system to play CD10 combat. You can just act rationally, so to speak. And that will work, because that's how the game system is designed. You don't need to know that you have a bonus action, a reaction, and a move, and you don't need to know any of that, because the system just fluidly adapts to what you're doing. I agree with you to a degree. You have to work within the mechanics and the world that is allowed you those mechanics. But there's still a lot of leeway. Work within the box and find beauty and creativity within that box kind of mentality. Yeah, I agree. I just personally have a very hard time being immersed when I'm rolling 12 dice and add it all together. And then my friend goes after me and he does his first attack and rolls 9 dice. He does his second attack and rolls 12 dice. And then he does his third attack and that's a crit, so he rolls 26 dice. It just becomes so slow and mechanics heavy. And that brings me out of the experience. I have a great deal of respect for those who can stay immersed in such a situation. I've heard people say they can do that. I just don't see how, personally, because I cannot. When that happens, I am definitely playing a game. I'm not my character anymore. And that's a problem for me, personally. There's no comparison between Selenia and D&D combat. You just, as a player, say, I stabbed the person, or whatever. There's no heavy maths or thinking, how do I squeeze the very last HP out of this monster? Yeah, I mean, there are mechanics, obviously, but most of those mechanics are handled by the GM, and they usually just affect things like distance, cover, hit locations, stuff like that. The GM handles that, not the player. And it doesn't take a long time to do either. I can definitely see what you're saying about how many rules there are in D&D about everything. Like, I'm a druid who uses shield, but I need a feat to be able to cast with a shield? Yeah, there's also those balancing issues. They make sense from a game design perspective, because D&D, as I said, is designed as a tactical simulation. It was a dungeon crawl in the very beginning that had to be balanced with mechanics. Basically, it was simulating combat mechanics with dice that they eventually evolved into computer games, computer role-playing games. And it has to be balanced, it has to make sense, it has to... Every class needs to be useful, and that does some weird things. The older versions of D&D, for instance, had the... If you were a caster, you cannot wear a ringmail. You can't put it on, because your class can't use it. And that's really weird. Of course I can wear it. These days it's more a case of I can wear it, but it inhibits my casting, etc, etc. Which makes more sense. It's still a bit weird, but it makes more sense. Yeah, D&D is admittedly more clunky of a system with respect to RP, and specifically in combat. Yeah. But there's a lot of minor flair, there's a lot of thinking in the moment and thinking in their shoes kind of stuff, at least from what my group does. Suboptimal moves happen so often on purpose in our game because it would make sense for the PCs to act in a suboptimal way as opposed to a tactical optimal way. Yeah, it makes combat more fun and real, but there's always that mechanical thinking in the background that I just can't get rid of, which is why I can't get immersed in D&D combat. Also, hi Addy, there's a lot of chat talking today, so welcome to RPG Discussions 101 while I try to make stat blocks. You gotta look for the beauty in the swamp sometimes. You gotta have that perspective. Without that, you'll never find it regardless of the actual system, I feel. That is also true. I mean, a murder hobo is gonna be a murder hobo, no matter what system he uses. I mean, I have played the CD10 system with a very new player who has murder hobo tendencies. And she does find ways to do strange things, but it's just the mechanics don't encourage it, but she still did things. It's that classic, I steal everything that isn't bolted down, and I don't care about anyone but myself kind of character. But at least you don't have min-maxers in CD10. I mean, I'm sure you can. There are probably ways to exploit this system to your advantage, but it doesn't really encourage it to the extent that D&D does. At least I don't hope so. But then again, CD10 is not designed to be a balanced system. It's not designed to be the one system to fit all, or one system to rule all. CD10 is one thing and one thing only. It is the system that I want to play. If other people enjoy it, that's great, but it is first and foremost the system I want to play. Otherwise, I wouldn't be doing it. Eyestalk. Now we're going getting to the really yummy stuff. As someone who isn't a murder hobo, I instead choose not to play a system like D&D. That is the beauty in choice. There are different types of players and different types of system, which is great. Yeah, and I'm also gonna say that you don't have to be a murder hobo to play D&D. I just wanna get that out there. What was the question? Well, I'm gonna mosey. Can you put the link in your world page up again before I leave? I can indeed. That should do it. There are both worlds. Oh, before you go, I should let you know that while a lot of that stuff is now locked behind Patreon, I'm going to overhaul my Patreon page and the rewards. So probably a lot more stuff is going to open up in the near future and not be behind the paywall. Because the thing is, as much as I want Selenia and CD10 to be published one day, I also want people to enjoy it, right? I want people to be excited, and they can't do that if everything is locked behind a paywall. So I want to expose more of the world and the setting to people so you can get excited, take part of it, and then choose to support me out of excitement or friendliness or whatever, right? And I can give you some more tangible rewards rather than here's my world. Of course, not everything's going to be open. I mean, the deep stuff, the deep dive stuff, characters, etc. might still be a bonus for the Patreons, but more of the setting will open up. Because as I said, I want to share this with people, and right now it doesn't feel right to have all of it locked. Really. Like writers and artists and such, they create the content they want to see or have read. Yeah, see, have, or read. Exactly. Absolutely, I think the overhaul is a great idea too. It'll likely draw more people in to check it out. Yes, and another thing is, if you want access to everything, it's basically a $35 thing. And while I have people who are Patreons at that level, it doesn't really sit right with me that that is a required level to get access to everything, because that's only like $15 away from what I believe the published purchase price will be. Paying $35 a month just to read stuff doesn't really sit right with me. So I'm gonna lower all of the Patreon rewards, but I'm gonna keep some high levels for the ones who really want to support, because there are those people. And they should be allowed to. I won't say no if anyone want to throw money at me, right? But I also want to give tangible rewards to lower level Patreons, so more people can support without feeling like it's a huge investment. And I'm still working on how to reward those people, because I do want to reward people for supporting. It's not a Kickstarter. It is a collaborative thing, and I want people to get something back from helping me. So yeah, still working on that part. You could have, like, patrons get to see the articles first and keep them locked for a few weeks, then release them to the public. Words are hard. It's a very common way to do it. Yeah, it is. Early access is a common part for Patreon, and it is one thing I'm considering. But we'll see. When I have the time to really sit down and knack something out, I will. My plan is that most people would want to
pledge at a, like a $5 level or something like that. Or maybe even a $3. And have the 10 and above for people who want to do something extra.
But we'll see. We shall see. We'll guess to it. Right now, I'm making ice logs. One of your eyes is extended on a flexible stalk. Not only does this freak people out, it allows you to look behind you and around corners using the stalk. I'll just remove that. In social situations, this might... incur a internal modifier of -2. Mutation, defect, and mutation disfigurement. It is kind of an advantage too, so that's why I put the modifier to the -2. Also, normal way to do it. Patreons get to see whips, works in progress, and polls about what to work and how to do things and such. Yeah. Correct. My problem with Patreon is that I have approached it in a very down-to-earth way. Because I'm really bad at marketing. So I don't want to have like clickbaity kind of things. Like, you get access to this first if you pay me money. But I think I kinda have to at least go a little bit in that direction. Because that's how people work. I just don't like it. But we'll see. We shall see. We shall see. I have a few ideas floating around, it's just that I don't have the time to actually sit down and do it. That's my biggest issue. I do not have the time! Also, I accidentally closed that without actually... Damn, that was not the one. Ugh. Stalk. I need the block ID. There you go. No, not racial starting traits. Traits and skills. Whoops. I almost created the... Hello. Can you reload? Also, music is way too loud. That is probably this song, though. This song is ridiculously loud. So I can just pull that down a bit. Like so, because this song is really loud. Now, let's see. Traits and skills. Here we go. I'm gonna add that last black. No, wait, I did that already. Yes, I did. Okay. What was the next one? Lipless. Lipless. You have no lips. Not only does this expose your teeth, you also have trouble speaking clearly and you drool and dribble uncontrollably. This is naturally freaking people out. People out, and in social situations, you are at a -3 internal modifier. Bet it causes awful breath. Dry teeth, ew. Yeah, it's probably not healthy. Disfigurement. Well, block number. Horned. Not horny. Horned. Traits and skills. Horned. The skull bone has deformed and you have grown two curly horns on your head. Superstition makes people distrust you and believe you're at least part fae. The horns are also sensitive, making you bang your heads on stuff and getting hurt. I don't think there's a modifier to this. Or is there? Actually, Druun Goatmen basically have this. always. The horns can be used as a primitive melee weapon. If you charge someone and stab them, or charge someone with the horns, they deal one blunt damage or bludgeoning damage. Damage and three shock. They also disturb people somewhat in social situations. So you are at a minus one modifier, internal modifier, for social interaction. Gotta offer them dentistics. Marcia says it keeps your dog breath all fresh. Indeed. Mutations. Hello? No, no, not there. There, mutation defense. Disfigurement. Hair changes. What's the next one? Leather skin. Ooh. Also have to add that block. There we go. Music loud! You're very sensitive today, aren't you? Really? It shouldn't be that loud. I don't know why. Strange. I think something has mucked up in my sound setting somewhere, because it shouldn't be this loud. So loud! Hey, King Axel King, sir!
How are you doing, my dear sir? Are you doing well?
Glad to hear you're doing well. See, Tim's agreeing with me. Of course he is. It is against me. He will agree to anything that is against me. He hates me. Waiting for lunch to warm up.
Lunch.
Oh, right. I was going to put that in. Did I put that in? I did put that in. So the next one was leather skin. Yes, yes, I hate the Toblin. Thank you. That is why you're hanging out in my chat. I really believe that, Nod.
Your skin is greenish brown, thick, oily, and leathery.
It offers you no benefits. It just looks and feels disgusting. I think I'm just gonna leave it at that. Defect. Defect. Yep, I hate him so much I want to watch him. Makes sense. Total sense. Did you just wake up or are you... Yeah, you're not coming off your shift right now, so you must have, like, gotten up recently? Leather skin. Oily leather skin. Tasty. Crispy grossness. Ah, you and your body horror stuff. For reals, man.
You need help. Seek treatment.
Get therapy. Nah, I've been up since 9. Just been dealing with appointments and exercise. Oh, that's good. I've gotten a crap ton of exercise today. I've walked so much today that my shins hurt.
Distension. Your blood vessels are swollen and large, giving you a hideous, veiny appearance.
The veins are bluish and swollen. Yeah, okay, that's enough. My shins also hurt. Wonder if other people make chips out of them. Out of what? You. In social... You know what? This whole social thing... I'm actually going to remove all the modifiers from these stat blocks. And just make a blanket statement under defects. That is a much easier way to do it and leaves it more in the hands of the GM what modifier he wants to apply, rather than saying this is 2, this is 3, this is 1. It's up to the GM. Like CD10 is designed, put it in the hands of the GM, rather than writing it down. That's a much better way to do it. Why didn't I do that to begin with? I am an idiot.
Sacramento idioto, io scrivo devo moppo.
Okay, so that's what I'm gonna do instead. Okay. Begins backing the fuck away from Nina's and Big Tooth's conversation. What? We're talking about oily leather? And like we called for him, Lily appears.
Indeed. You are like creepy crawlies.
They're discussing how to make chips out of mutants, I think, which is a little bit weird. But welcome to my chat. That's what happened here. Misshapen face. This figure. Severe disfigurement.
Your face is twisted and corrupted. Your cheekbones are uneven. Eyes are at uneven levels. Your nose is either huge or comically small. Your mouth is crooked and your ears are at different levels. Bruh! You is ugly.
And on the tail end of that, I'm gonna go get supper. Be right back. I'm getting hungry here. But I can't go right now. I have work to do here.
I have some things I must finish before I can go on with my life.
Traits and skill. Speaking of which, shouldn't there be a... Oh, there. Believe it or not, there's actually 11 viewers right now. That's kind of huge for this chat, for this stream.
I love it. I like this interaction.
That we can talk and discuss things. And you watch me doing basically administration, which is what this is. I'm just moving things from one point to the other. But it needs to be done in order to perfect the system.
Emaciated.
I already have the Droon meat jacket. Oh, that is so horrible. No matter your physical condition, you look as if though you should have died from starvation 3 weeks ago. Your bones are visible under your skin and your face is sunken and gaunt. These are so nice. Nasty. You're a machine today, Tobes. You're knocking these out like crazy. Well, the thing is, I'm cheating. I have already made them. The thing I'm doing right now is I'm moving them to their individual blocks. Because if you remember a discussion from way back, I wanted to turn the disfigurement mutation into individual mutations. So you have many more disfigurements you can get. So I'm kind of cheating. But the thing is, I can also make more mutations now, which is awesome. Shit, please. Still getting a ton done. It's gonna look so good. Yeah. It is going to look amazing. What was this? Tentacle limb.
Tentacle. One of your limbs have reshaped into a fleshy, flexible tentacle.
The tentacle can have any color you decide on and fill the function of a normal limb, even a leg. It feels very wiggly and noodly. Wiggly, noodly, and horrific.
Fit in these tenebrous places. I can't do the Darkest Dungeon narrator. He's so good, though.
Wiggly, noodly, and horrific. Right up my alley. Well, with that, we have finished all the existing disfigurements. We are going to add more eventually. I have a lot more ideas for disfigurements. But for now, we actually have added the ones that I wanted. Like so. And right, I'm gonna make a note to myself. No, I'm actually gonna make that right in the article right here. Defects table. Blanket statement about defects impacting social interactions. Insert.